Take your scriptures, and if you will, turn to Psalms 140, verse 4. The psalmist puts this, and he says, "For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the humble with salvation."
Amen.
This morning we are finishing up talking about the restoration of the relationship. And the title of today's sermon is Good News. I think all of you know what that is a picture of. I think we have a misconception of what good news is, just like the hillbilly. Now, the story is told about someone from Tennessee, but I don't want to put down anyone from Tennessee. We'll make it a hillbilly from Western North Carolina. Certainly there are no hillbillies here, right? So the old hillbilly, no, don't look that direction. The old hillbilly had to bring his family in to the big city. Had to go and talk to the government folks. And when he got to the building, he was trying to figure out how he could get up to the floor where he was at. And, you know, it was looking around, and he noticed this thing that was called an elevator. Never seen one of them before. So he was wondering what that thing did. And he was watching this little old haggard lady as she hobbled over to that elevator. She pushed the button, the doors opened, she walked in. That's interesting. I wonder what the elevator does. So he kept watching. And a few minutes went by. And walked out of the doors. As the doors opened, he saw this beautiful young woman coming out of the doors. And he was going, "Oh my land!" So he called over to his son, in the same way. We misunderstand what the good news is. Turn it on. The word for good news in Greek, and you will find this all through the New Testament, is euangelion. And euangelion is actually first found in Mark chapter 1, verse 1. And euangelion is always a word that is connected with something. Euangelion, when we translate it, is translated in one of two ways. It is translated as good news or gospel. And in fact, it is a combination of two words in Greek. Ou, which means good. And angelon, which means message. We transliterate this word euangelion, and instead of a U, we put a B, and we get the word evangelism. Although sometimes I'm not sure in evangelism we're always giving good news. Amen. I think that some of you have this idea about what good news is, because the good news is always tied with Jesus Christ. By the way, the euangelion is also the word that we get for angel. So angel is in there also, along with evangelism. We have a lot of words we steal from different languages. Do you know that in English? But the good news in the New Testament is always tied with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
whole, the good news or gospel is a word that is brought together in the New Testament. I think we have found that it is also in the Old Testament. That's why I wanted to begin with Psalm 149, verse 4. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the humble with salvation. I want to tell you the idea of beauty is something that actually comes from God. Now, I know that we have a misunderstanding of the idea of beauty. In our household, the first room that you come into the door, of course, is the hallway, but right off of it is the dining room. My wife doesn't like this. We have a bad habit that everything goes onto the table when we come in. None of your other husbands do this, right? Okay? And every once in a while, she gets mad at us. And we got to clear that table off because my wife likes a beautiful dining table. I know, Wes. I lost your wife there a minute ago. She was pointing to you. I got it this week. The table got cleaned up so it could be beautified. I want you to understand that it always starts, the beautification of us always starts with the Lord saying, I take pleasure in. He takes pleasure in his people. We get the idea that God does not love us, that God does not care for us. God is a lover of us. He created us from the beginning. The purpose of creation is that he wanted to have relationship with us. And so what you take pleasure in is what you are in love with. And too many of you are in love with this. You can't go anywhere without it. Keep it by your side. Amen. It's a piece of work that I will tell you, I'm going to be honest, sometimes you're going to call me and you won't get me because I leave my phone behind because there are other things that matter to me. Think about the person who pleasures you. Do you want to be with them? God has pleasure in you. He wants to be with you. He created us in such a way that he made everything perfect. He made it beautiful. His purpose was that together we would work on this world so that it would become, because let's face it, we're all trying to make this world a better place for us. Isn't that true? Think about your home, what you do. Just like my wife fixing up the table. You want the house to look nice. So when the paint gets grungy, what do? We repaint, right? We do things in order to make things beautiful. How many of you like going around in an ugly car? You don't, do you? You want to have a car that looks nice? You want everything. We like beauty in this world. Amen? So God wants to beautify us with salvation. As you can see, I got a new shirt for my suit. My wife finally said she'd had enough of the other one. It had a few holes. I like holy clothes. Any of the other of you men like holy clothes? They get nice and comfortable. New shirts are a little scratchy. I always make sure that she washes them first. But But I got to admit, that shirt got to the point where it had holes, and it was kind of getting a little disgraceful. Folks, we are disgraceful without the salvation of God. We need new clothing. We're even promised it in Revelation, the third chapter. I'm not going to spend time with that. You look it up. Revelation 3 talks about the need of raiment. I'd like you to turn to Romans, the third chapter. Romans chapter 3, verses 22 to in actuality of 26. The thought there in Revelation 3, actually, the whole thought begins at the end of verse 22. You will see in your Bibles that there will be a capital with the word for. That's where I want you to be. So it's 22b. It's towards the end of 22. For there is no difference. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by His blood through faith, to demonstrate the righteousness, because in His forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed, to demonstrate at the present time His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. I want you to understand what is being said here. I need to go back so that you will understand. The thought here is what Paul has been setting up in Romans chapter 1. Chapter 2 and chapter 3 before this, he lays out the natural world has a certain type of way of doing things. And we know what right or wrong is based upon the natural world. Although in this day and age, we try to deny that. There is also another thing. God has revealed not only what He wants in the natural world, He has also revealed Himself in the Bible. And so we have this thing, we know what we should naturally do, what we should be like, and the problem is we fight against that. Because why? What is our problem?
Sin.
Manuscript, number 15, 1900, Ellen White. God always demands good works. The law demands it. But because man placed himself in sin, where his good works were what? What were they? What were they? They were valueless. You see, we know what is demanded of us. Whether it is out in nature, whether it is in God's Word, God is demanding that we will keep the laws that are needed to do. And how good do we do on things? We know what some of the laws are. We're supposed to keep good exercise. We're supposed to eat the right foods. We're supposed to... How am I doing? I'm just doing the nature things right now. Now I can get into the commandments. You know what the commandments say. Thou shalt have no other God before me. You shall not make graven images. You shall not use my name in vain. Remember the seventh day to keep it holy. Honor your father and mother. That you, I can keep going, folks. Thou shalt not bear false witness. The average American tells 20 lies a day. Ma'am, do you know why I pulled you over?
Why, no, officer, I have no idea.
Oh, come on. You didn't know you were driving 20 over the speed limit? You know what I'm talking about. See, here's the problem. All of the best that we can do is valueless, because the great problem is, why do we often do that? A lot of us come to church unselfish because I have earned the proper rallying points. I was bad this week, so I need to go to church. But if you're going to church for that reason, the reason why you're doing this is valueless. Jesus, righteousness alone, can avail. The whole thing that Paul said there in the first chapter when I read to you is that the only way that we can make it, because it says that he was propitiation. Do you know what propitiation means? If the law demands that good works, and God demands good works, do you know what it's going to cost if you do something wrong? 20 lives a day. The sentence is death. You do know that, don't you? It doesn't matter how small it is. It doesn't matter if it was inconsequential. A lie means death. Propitiation means that he paid the price that the law is demanding of your sin and my sin. When you die, can you bring yourself back to life? I'm old enough to remember the program called Emergency. I remember that was the first time I saw the paddles charge it up. And the first ones, they didn't even say clear like they say today. Come on, charge them up, and they stuck those paddles on them. You know, saw the person. Can you put the paddles on yourself? I was there last year as my father is struggling for every breath along the way, and there's nothing that he can do in order to make things better. And all we can do is talk about, Dad, you're going to be okay, and they have to put in the right medicines. They had to shock his heart back into rhythm again. There was nothing that my father could do in order to make himself better at that point. He had to rely. Folks, the only way that we are ever going to make it is through Jesus Christ, and that's the good news. We spend way too much time in church looking at sins that people are committing. I know what goes on. Just wait a minute, I'm going to get back to you. Folks, we know what the problem is. That side of the church is not good. Our sins are better than their sins. Come on, folks, are you going to let them get away with that? They say your sins are worse than their sins. We know that they're worse sinners than you are, right? So what we begin to judge is remember what it said, all have sinned and fallen short. And so we are saying that we are doing good because what? I'm a sinner, you're a sinner, so my sins are better than your sins? Do you begin to see what the problem is? That's why everything we do becomes valueless, because we measure it by sin instead of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only sinless being that there is. And we should spend more time talking about Jesus in this church.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now, folks, I know how to make people feel guilty. I learned from the best person there was. My mother knew how to give guilt. She was good at it. She used to line us all up. Okay, I want to find out who did it. So she'd start with me. I'm the oldest. Although I can present you information, it's all a lie. I can present you information that makes all my siblings older. I told you it was a lie. I'm the oldest, so she would start with me. Did you do it? Get down there to my sister. Did you do it? We have a perfect system. Just watch how this works. Got down to my next brother. Did you do it? By the way, I have one sister, two brothers. I'm down to the third one. Now we get to the fourth one. And by the time she got here, we had the perfect passage. Depends. It was perfect. We could get away with any sin. We'd all kick it down the path. There was my brother. Until one day, my mother went down, all the way down to the line, and finally my youngest brother figured it out. And so when my mother got there, did you do it? He went, and all of us up the line were, huh? Can't do righteousness like that. Pointing at one another doesn't solve anything. All of us are sinners. All of us have broken the law. The only hope we have is in Jesus Christ. He paid the price for sin. So if there's any of you that thinks that you are righteous here without Jesus Christ, shame on you. Okay, I did get a guilt pardon. Right? Had to do it. Pastor's got to talk about the wrong. Where you're wrong. Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 10 is a repetition of Jeremiah the 31st chapter. And by the way, that's where one of my favorite texts is Jeremiah 31 verse 3, where God says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. The sad thing is in this country, we provide for a no-excuse type of divorce. You don't have to even prove that one of the partners is wrong. It's no fault, can easily get divorced from one another. But I want to tell you something. God says that He will love you everlastingly. He never sees divorce on His side.
Amen.
For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put the law in their minds and write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people.
Amen.
See, here's the problem. I expressed before in the last reading that it's very clear that the nature demands, God demands that you do everything right. And you all know what those are. That's a representation of the tablets that God wrote on. By the way, that's the only part of the Bible that was actually written by God. You do know that, don't you? God wrote that. We like to slice it and dice it and think that we can do things, but I'm telling you, God wrote those Ten Commandments. And here's the problem. It is not natural for us to keep those Ten Commandments. We would like to. But what happens the moment that we get out of bed? We usually go to the bathroom, get something to drink, and then we go on our day. And is God even a part of our day at that point? At least I will give this to what the Jews do. Before they leave the house, they have the law of God right there, and they make sure that they touch it each day. But we think that we can live our life without the law of God, and we can't, because this is what God created us to be. You can deny it all that you want to. You can think that we are going to solve all the problem, and I've heard Christians that you shouldn't vote for this one or that one because they'll never solve the problems of our country. They will never solve the problems of our country. Only Jesus Christ can solve the problems. God says, if you will love me and trust me, you will accept the salvation that I give you. Then he says, I will put the law in your mind. You see, the problem is when sin came about, it moved us away from God. We didn't trust God anymore. We thought along the way, we believe this lie, and if you eat it, you will never die. How are we doing on that? I've done a funeral for a 3-month-old. How are we doing on that one? Thou shalt never die. Why are we believing in something that is not true? We think along the way, if we will just exercise and do all the right things, we will never die. Or, if you believe it, here's the pill that will provide all the answers that you need. And I know some of our members work in the drug business. I don't think there's a perfect pill yet. Is there? The only thing that I know that is perfect is God. And he will write the law in your mind and in your heart. He will take care of everything you need. Here's what you need to do, folks. This is from a little book called Steps to Christ. If you haven't read it, you need to read it. Consecrate yourself to God in the morning. Make this your very first work. Let your prayer be, take me, O Lord, as fully thine. I lay all my plans at your feet. Use me today in your service. Abide with me and let all my work be wrought in you. Farther down it says, your weakness is united in his strength, your ignorance in his wisdom, your frailty in his enduring might. How many of you go all day long in your own strength, in your own might? Let me ask you, folks. What will be the end result if we rely upon human means in order to solve the problems of this world? I hope you're going to understand what I'm doing right now, Rick. I'm not talking against light rail. I think that it is a good thing. But I've heard some people say that if we go to light rail, we will take all these cars off the road and we will solve the problem of pollution. They did a study in Houston before I left. If they took all of those cars off the road, in a 10-year period, they published as if it would solve all the pollution problems except. Are you ready for me? All the pollution of manufacturing those cars, the electricity and everything that's put out, the same amount of pollution is put out by the light rail. Because in 10 years, you have to redo the whole thing. You have to pay the cost and the pollution that goes along with it. And you know what they found the difference in the pollution was? Nothing! You have the same amount of pollution here as you do over here. We don't know how to live in this world without polluting it. Do we? And I'm old enough to remember when we put out this Protection Act in order to make our world environmentally better as far as pollution. And by the way, if you think it was a Democrat, it was a Republican president that signed it into law. So I don't care about this Democrat, Republican business, throw it out the window. Have we solved pollution? We make this world a worse place because we don't know anything. Because we don't rely upon God, do we, Miss Joan? We think we have the answers when we need to rely completely upon the God of heaven. 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 through 13. This verse has always hit home with me. When I was a young man, I was still a student at Southern Missionary College, doing my undergraduate in religion. And I was assigned to be in Columbia, South Carolina. I took 6 months off from my study in order to be there and stay after an evangelist. And I remember going to a member's house. She was 90 years old, but she'd been a member of the church for years. She said out to me, "I'm about to die, and I'm not sure that I am going to be saved." This is a testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son.
Amen.
He who has the Son might have life. See, that's how I love it when you read it. He who has the Son has life. I want you to look at it differently. I'll teach you something in math. We have equality here. You have Son equals life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. Now, if I remember my math correctly, is don't have Son, so I can do that with a circle and put a cross in it, means that with the equal sign, I'll put a cross across the equal sign. And it means that if I'm going to life, it means that I don't have life. It doesn't equal life. If I don't have Jesus, I don't have life. If you want to have the assurance of salvation, you need to have Jesus Christ in your life each and every day, each and every moment, each and every second. There is no time to waste. Do you have Jesus in your life?
Amen.
These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. Now, folks, I can't prove this scientifically. I can prove this. I did something, if you notice, there was a difference in the picture. This is easy to prove. I did it purposely. You can see the difference, can't you? What's the difference? Well, if you're unsure about that with me going back and forth like this, one of the ways that you can do this, we can get a ruler out, we can measure it, but folks, this relationship with Jesus Christ cannot be measured by a ruler. Are you accepting of the testimony? I have written these these things that you might believe. If you have Jesus, you have life. Do you believe in the testimony of God's word? I know that I'm a sinful human being and I do not deserve it, but I believe in Jesus Christ and I have eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. And that's my testimony, folks. We spend way too much time talking about sin when we should talk about Jesus Christ. If we point to Jesus Christ, if we make him the emphasis, the whole world begins to change. Is there anyone here who really deserves eternal life? But you do through Jesus Christ. It's like this new shirt I got. Have the covering of Jesus over my life. And what I am praying for is each and every moment that what people see is not me. They see Jesus. While I finish up with this last illustration, I want the deacons to pass out cards to you. I want everyone to fill out a card this morning. So the deacons are going to come forward. They're going to give you cards. I want you to fill them out. I know that some of you say, oh, but Pastor, I'm a good church member. Yeah, you might be, you might not be. There's certain questions that are on there. I'd like to know what your response is. And yes, I know you may be a member of this church, but I expect your name on the card. And I would appreciate you putting down your cell phone number because I'm amazed that in this church I do not have everyone's cell phone number. So go ahead and pass out those cards. First thing I want you to do is I want you to put your name. I want you to definitely put your cell phone number on. Everyone, whether you're a church member or not, I want your name on. Because you see, folks, I believe that each and every Sabbath, the issue is just like the picture is going. This is from Revelation, the third chapter. And it says that Jesus stands at the door, and what does he do? He knocks. And the Bible says that if you hear his voice, you see, he's not just knocking, he is asking. And I believe that he is saying our name specifically, and he is calling out to you. And each and every Sabbath, you have a choice that you need to make. And I am asking each one of you to make a consideration of what you're doing here this morning. And the purpose of doing this, of giving you this card, is I want you to fill this out. God is knocking on your heart, and he is asking some of these questions, and I want you to consider them this morning. Do you believe this? I am a sinner in need of a Savior. If you believe that, I want you to check the card there that says, I believe I am a sinner in need of a Savior. The next one, God loves me and I will give my life to him each day. Whatever you got on Sabbath morning, it needs to be continued on Sunday morning. Monday, oh Lord, we need it on Monday morning. Amen. Are you giving your life to Jesus Christ each day of your life? Folks, you may be a little long on that, but if that's your desire, I still want you to check on that. I want to be a part of a people who trust Jesus. haven't read the bulletin, you will see. If you look on there, you will see that we have a statement of what we as a church are looking to. We want to know Him. We want to love others. We're looking forward to Jesus Christ's soon return. If you want to be a part of this type of people, check number 3. And the last one there, if you're not a member of this church and you would like to become a member of this church, I want you to check number 4.
Stand and sing together hymn number 99. God will take care of you. This is a wonderful promise of God's faithfulness. All 4 verses, hymn number 99. God will take care of you.
Salvation, come forward. We want to pray for you.
Amen.
So while I'm finishing this prayer right now with an amen, when we pick up the song again, if you have either of these two desires, you've been struggling against God and you want help, or if you want to know that you are saved by Jesus Christ, come on down to the front. And I ask this in Jesus' holy name. Face towards you and give you